Welcome everybody to Algebra 2, 4B.3, Solving Polynomial Equations When Factoring Doesn't Work by Hand. This is a section that is devoted to appreciating all those things that we've seen come together about polynomial functions. How can we finally put those pieces together and use them to solve the nasty ones? Just a bit of a warning, you can see it's a short lesson. There are very few examples, there are very few problems on your assignment, because this right here is the pinnacle of our polynomial work. We understand that these problems take some time, and we just want to foster within you a little bit of appreciation for, you know, where all this stuff that our technology can do for us, where does that come from? And how does everything that we've learned about these polynomials fit perfectly into place? Why does it make perfect sense? So I hope we've been explaining that pretty well as we've gone along. Now let's put the pieces together. So here, just very, very bluntly, I've put all the steps for today. So step one, when we look at a polynomial function and it's set equal to zero, we're going to list the possible rational zeros with that rational root theorem. What are our possibilities for nice, clean, real number rational results? Step two, we're going to determine possible positive and negative real zeros using Descartes' rule of signs. We want to determine how many possibilities we have on either side of the y-axis. And you'll notice I put asterisks next to those. Those aren't really necessary to write out each time. It's good thought for you to carry through, but it's not necessary. Step three is really where we can begin our actual write it down on paper work. Step three is to attempt synthetic division with some of those potential zeros that we may or may not have listed out. We're looking for a zero remainder in synthetic division, and it may take a few tries. So we may test a one, not work. Test a negative one, not work. Test a two, doesn't work, before we find something that does give us a zero remainder. Step four, we're going to repeat this process until we are left with something that is factorable, or we can keep using synthetic division if we feel up to it. And step five, we're going to find any remaining zeros that we couldn't get by using factoring, quadratic formula, or square roots. Hopefully, by the end of step four, after we've done our synthetic division work, we can use factoring. It's so much faster to finish a problem that way. But if not, we've got some other fallback options as well. All right. So it's, again, we're not trying to hide behind the fact that this is something that takes some time, but again, hopefully we can go nice and slow through this process and kind of appreciate all the steps along the way. So for this function j of x, to find its zeros, the first thing I'm going to do is look at its possible rational zeros. So let's make a list of those possibilities. Thankfully, my leading coefficient is just a 1. So I've got plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 4, plus or minus 6, plus or minus 8, plus or minus 12, plus or minus 24. All those factors of the constant 24, and there are a bunch, but they're all over 1. There's no need for messing around with fractional values, thankfully. All right, let's look at Descartes' rule of signs. Our possible positive number of zeros, let's see, no, one sign change. There's one possible positive real zero, and then if I quickly jot down j of negative x, 1, 2, possible negative real zeros, there could be 2 or there could be 0. Right, so it looks like my possibilities are pretty well laid out there. Here's where I said this is stuff that hopefully we're thinking through, but it really isn't completely necessary to evaluate. Let's go ahead and look at those possibilities I've listed out in blue and try some synthetic division. So first I'm going to test a positive 1. I've got 1x cubed plus 3x squared minus 10x minus 24. Thankfully, we did not have any gaps, no like 0x to the seconds or something like that. We didn't need any zero placeholders here, thankfully. But this synthetic division, hopefully we got a pretty nice appreciation for that pattern. Drop down the first value, 1 times 1 is 1, 3 plus 1 is 4, 1 times 4 is 4, negative 10 plus 4 is negative 6, 1 times negative 6 is negative 6. I can clearly see that when I add those up, I'm not going to get a remainder of 0. So that one has failed. Let's try negative 1. And again, we know that this might take some tries. We just want to be careful along the way. Oh, negative 1 didn't work either. Well, let's try positive 2. 1, 3, negative 10, negative 24. Now, I'm writing all these out separately. It's totally fine if you just erase the work that you've done when you find out 1 doesn't work, just so you don't have to keep writing this stuff every time. 2, and 5, and 10, and 0, 0. Oh, unfortunately, that doesn't work. Let's try negative 2. -2, -2, -12, 24. Hey, that one worked. So I know that my list of zeros, and this is where it all starts to come together, this is amazing. -2 was a zero of that polynomial. And I know that it was a third degree polynomial, there's only 2 more. So let's take a look at this depressed polynomial that's left. That's x squared plus 1x minus 12. Where does that equal to 0? Hey, all right, we can use magic numbers. We could keep going with synthetic division and then make this our top row and test some more values if we wanted. But really, if you can magic number your way through this, it's much faster to finish the problem that way. Maybe what we got down here isn't factorable. We could use quadratic formula and finish the problem that way as well. But here I found that x equals negative 4. X equals 3 are my remaining zeros, so -2, -4, and +3 are all the zeros there. And again, it kind of looks like the chalkboard of a crazy person if you're to step back and look at this, all those numbers just kind of scribbled around there. But I hope we can see the process behind it. The synthetic division was testing possible rational zeros that we had found, and ultimately we came up with -2 being the first one that worked. And I like to structure my list and then just kind of work my way down this list as I go through synthetic division, just because the numbers are easier to work with early on when you have ones and twos. And, you know, we'll talk about, in the next lesson, we'll talk about what to do in more complicated situations. But, you know, for right here, this didn't work out too bad. But again, I hope we can appreciate taking our time and just grinding our way through a problem. The sense of satisfaction you get in finishing a problem like this is so great. Now let's try one more with a leading coefficient. So here we got, a lead coefficient that's not 1. Here we got 3x to the 3rd. So let's start off, I'll keep my same colors that I did last time. We'll start off with blue for our possible rational zeros. I've got +/-1/1, +/-2/1, +/-4/1, +/-8/1. +/-1/3, +/-2/3, +/-4/3, +/-8/3. I'm certainly hoping that synthetic division gives me a zero remainder before I get to all those fractions, but it's nice to know all my possibilities laid out. Synthetic division still works with fractions. All right, then let's look at Descartes' rule of signs. I got 1, 2, 3. Okay, 3 or 1. 3 sign changes, count down from by 2s from there. We saw that in the last lesson. So there's a possibility for a lot of positives. That's good, because that tells me in synthetic division, I probably want to look at my positive possibilities first. All right, I didn't give this function a name, so let's just call this k of x. Odd powers, change signs, evens, absorb, odds, change signs. And you can see all these terms are negative. This is really valuable information now, because I know that there are no possible negative real zeros. So when I'm doing synthetic division, I don't want to waste my time plugging in a -1 or a -2 or a -4, because they're not going to show up. Let's start with +1. 3x to the 3rd, -6x squared, 4x, -8. 3, 3, -3, -3, 1, 1. Okay, that didn't work. Let's try negative. Oh, we're not going to try -1. Let's try 2. Looking for that 0 remainder. 3, 6, 0, 0, 4, 8. Hey, all right, that worked. So we got a positive 2 to work. And I'm really glad, just out of habit, I tried negative 1. But then I glanced up at this part of the board and said, hey, don't be testing any negative numbers in synthetic division. That disagrees with Descartes. We don't want to disagree with him. All right, so my depressed polynomial. Sorry, I guess I should start compiling my answer here. So for the zeros of this function, I've got x equals 2 through my synthetic division. The depressed polynomial, that 3, 0, 4 that I had before my remainder, that tells me that I've got 3x squared plus no x's plus 4 that I can solve the rest of the way. And looking at this, it's not something I certainly want to try to factor or anything like that. I really am zeroing in on the fact that this, pun intended, zeroing, I'm really looking in at that x squared being the only place I have to solve for x. This is a good opportunity to use the square root property. So let's subtract 4 from both sides, divide both sides by 3. I'm trying to isolate that thing that's squared. So then I can square root both sides. Oh, and we got some imaginary solutions. That's totally possible, because we needed to get 3 total solutions. There were 3 zeros here. It's third degree, fundamental theorem of algebra. So it's I times the square root of 4 over the square root of 3. And the square root of 4 is just 2, so plus or minus 2i over root 3. And to put that into proper format, x equals plus or minus 2i root 3 over 3. So those are my two remaining solutions. That third degree polynomial. We got 3 zeros. Now, I do want to stress that when you get to that very end, the square root property is what I saw as being the fastest way to solve this. But could you use quadratic formula? Absolutely. You'd get to the exact same answer. It may just require a bit more simplifying on your part. Okay, I should also add that if you had left your answers, say you got to this point right here and you just said x equals plus or minus I square root of 4/3, that would be considered acceptable right now, simply because we haven't talked about how to simplify radical answers further. But you should know that from your geometry class and all your work with special right triangles. So I would hope we would get to the answers in blue, but realize that the answers in red would be acceptable. All right, and our second example has us kind of shift gears and work in reverse. So we've talked about how we have conjugate pairs and the fundamental theorem of algebra, and can we put that together in reverse? You know, that's going to develop a complete understanding for us. So with letter A, you'll notice I've got 1, 2, 3 zeros that are given. That means my answer should be a polynomial with degree 3. So let's think our way back through this. When we have a zero, that came out of a factor. And a factor is just x minus that zero, right? So I've got x minus 0, x minus a negative 4, and then x minus 3 over 2. Well, man, if I got a zero that's a fraction, I first added 3 and divided by 2. So that must be a 2x minus 3. So a little bit of thinking with those fractional zeros. But hopefully we've seen enough of them so far that we can kind of work our way backwards to this point. So we go from zeros to factors. I might clean up this x minus 0. I know that if I get x equals 0 for an answer, that means it was just a loose x in my factors. And now it's just a matter of foiling and distributing. My rule of thumb, and this is in no way set in stone, but do your most difficult foiling first. So in this case, that lone x out front, I'm going to wait and distribute that at the end. I've got 2x squared minus 3x plus 8x minus 12. I'm going to do that difficult foiling first and then distribute the x. So there's my polynomial. It's third degree, which is great because I had three zeros that were given. And we multiplied all those factors together to arrive there. Let's take a look at letter B, because this one has something interesting. It's that square root 5. It's irrational. And remember, irrational solutions always come in conjugate pairs. So if I see a square root of 5, I know instantly that its conjugate, negative root 5, is also there. All right, so let's set up our factors. X minus negative 5, X minus root 5, and X minus a negative root 5. All right, let's do our most difficult foiling first. And remember, we're going to come up with a polynomial, so we should have nice, clean integers showing up. In other words, I don't want to end up with a function that has a root 5 in it somewhere. So I'm going to hold on to this X plus 5. Let's do our foiling here. X times X is X squared plus root 5 times X minus root 5 times X when I do the outside and inside for foil. And then last times last, negative. Picture what's happening here. I'm taking a root 5 times itself. That's just a regular old 5. But it was a negative times a positive, so it will be a negative 5 when I multiply those together. So I've got x squared. If I combine the like terms in the middle, sure enough, there go the root 5 terms. X squared minus 5. And now let's foil the rest. First, inside, outside, last. You'll notice that that polynomial came out nice and clean, no root 5s remaining. That's a nice check if you've made a mistake or not. You should not end up with any square root symbols left in your answer. All right, and finally, here we've got two zeros given. However, one of those zeros, that 2 minus 3i, notice that's a complex number. And it's imaginary. And so if we have imaginary numbers, those come in conjugate pairs as well when they're solutions. So I should know 2 plus 3i is also included. Let's write out our factors, x minus negative 1, x minus 2 minus 3i, x minus 2 plus 3i. We're going to do our most difficult foiling first, and that means this monstrosity. So you just wait for a second, x plus 1, we'll get to you. And this, I casually refer to it as super foiling in class, right? So we've got to take this x and distribute it to everything. So x squared minus 2x plus 3ix. This negative 2, I've got to distribute that to everything. Minus 2x plus 4 minus 6i. And then lastly, this negative 3i, I have to distribute that to everything. Minus 3ix plus 6i. And then negative 3 times 3 is negative 9. I times I is I squared. And we saw this back in section 3.2. Whenever we have I squared, remember that means the same thing as negative 1. So this negative 9i squared is really negative 9 times negative 1. It's really a plus 9. Man, am I glad I got this out of the way. Let's see how this guy cleans up. Anything that has a square root, and remember I means the square root of negative 1, should cancel out. And sure enough, we see that happening. I've got x squared minus 4x, then I've got a plus 4 and a plus 9. That's plus 13. All that nastiness of the imaginary terms is gone. But we're not quite out of the water yet. We've still got to distribute this x. X to the third minus 4x now to the second plus 13x. And we have to distribute this plus 1. That's easy enough. Just take everything in there times 1. And we'll combine our like terms. We get x to the third minus 3x to the second plus 9x plus 13. There's our third degree polynomial that produced those three zeros. That does it for 4B.3, the first part, where we did all this work by hand. And again, really, I'm hoping that all the repetition with these steps that we're seeing is really starting to connect. We're always looking for connections here. And I certainly hope that this is starting to bring some of those things together. We're going to blow the doors off this thing when we introduce technology in the next section.